Welcome to the broadcast. It was a remarkable day in Washington. The president calling himself a sinner. The independent counsel saying there is grounds for an impeachment. We have a consideration of this day in Washington with Lawrence Tribe of Harvard Law School, Bill Buckley of the National Review, Margaret Carlson of Time Magazine, and Gardner Taylor, the esteemed preacher.
Well, it's all about what you will see when the report comes out. It's all about an orchestrated scheme to obstruct justice. That's the other shoe that didn't really drop today.
The utter and total mess that he and the country are in have resulted from his systematic exploitation of a situation which nobody with a grain of sense would expose himself to. And for that reason, I think he's simply incapacitated. But, you know,
it's all going to come down to whether the perjury that Starr documents in this report is impeachable, and whether impeachment is the punishment that fits that crime.
But to go into all of these graphic details and to spread them before the American people, it seems to me that this is a deliberate attempt to smear and to destroy.
For a further consideration of the moral implications of the crisis surrounding the presidency, we consider the views of two men who were at the prayer breakfast. They are the Reverend Philip Wogaman and the Reverend James Forbes.
To discard him now, what a message that would send to millions of people who struggle with these same issues and who need the same kind of forgiveness that he needs and need to be able to reconstitute their lives and move ahead.
I think I experienced a man who believes this is a watershed moment and that his character and approach to life will be impacted by the values that have reasserted themselves in the light of this conflict.
We conclude not with more politics, but with tennis. The U.S. Open will conclude this weekend. We'll talk about the men's and women's finalists.
I don't think I've ever seen Rafter play better. He's serving and volleying, chipping and charging. He's such a great athlete. I think that's going to be a terrific match tomorrow between Sampras and Rafter.
And, of course, everybody from the United States standpoint hopes that Lindsay Davenport can walk away tomorrow with her first ever Grand Slam title. She's two in the world, and she's been chasing Hingis all summer, playing really the best tennis of anyone on the tour, only had one loss since Wimbledon. So Davenport's looking good.
The crisis of the presidency and tennis championships when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
The 445-page report that could bring down the president was released to the public today. It was released by the Congress on the Internet. It was prepared by the Office of the Independent Counsel. It lists 11 grounds for possible impeachment. It includes allegations of perjury, obstruction of justice, interfering with a witness, and abuse of presidential power. The president offered an emotional apology in a speech to religious leaders delivered earlier in the morning.
I agree with those who have said that in my first statement after I testified, I was not contrite enough. I don't think there is a fancy way to say that I have sinned. It is important to me that everybody who has been hurt know that the sorrow I feel is genuine. First and most important, my family, also my friends, my staff, my cabinet, Monica Lewinsky and her family, and the American people. I have asked all for their forgiveness.
Joining me now from Boston, Lawrence Tribe, constitutional law professor at Harvard University. From Stamford, Connecticut, William F. Buckley, Jr., editor-at-large of the National Review, will be joining us in just a few minutes. Here in New York, Margaret Carlson, columnist for Time Magazine, and the Reverend Gardner Taylor of the Concord Baptist Church of Christ. I am pleased to have all of them to talk about the president, the report, and the country today. I go first to Lawrence Tribe in Boston. Help us understand the notion of impeachment and how you see it and this report, the kinds of charges it lays out. I know you've read a bit of it. Do you see impeachable offenses based on the prosecutor's documents?
Well, I've read, Charlie, about two-thirds of it. I think I've read sort of the meat of the thing. And I must say, as someone who dreaded the publication of this report, and as someone who was, I think, pretty open-minded about what it would prove, I'm very underwhelmed. I think it is generally agreed that the concept of impeachment, which goes back for centuries, is really separate from concepts in criminal law. It's designed to remove from office, not necessarily punish, but remove from office those who gravely abuse the power of the office and subvert the system of government. That can be done in a lot of ways. One can subvert the system of government the way Richard Nixon did. One might subvert it by a genuine orchestrated plot to obstruct justice. But as you read this report, you get the distinct feeling of sort of an X-rated movie where the words perjury and obstruction of justice and witness tampering are sort of thrown in the way plots used to be thrown into those movies in order to have them pass some kind of censorship standard. Because this baloney has been sliced awfully thin. That is, when you look at this report, you find, for example, that the mere fact that the president, who has obviously admitted that what he did was terrible and that he ought not to have lied about it, when the president lied not only to the nation as a whole, but to seven or eight of his aides, who, of course, then would go out and repeat what he had said, that is supposed to be an abuse of presidential power and an obstruction of justice. It's like the 13th chime of a clock. It really makes you wonder about everything that has gone before. It is very hard in this report to see anything other than lots and lots of verbal footwork, some by the president, but some by the independent counsel, designed to paper over the fact that in the end, even more than I thought it would be, this is really about a terrible course of sexual misconduct, which of course the president tried to hide. And it's hard to compare it to the kinds of genuine high crimes and misdemeanors.
So in
that
covering
history
up,
has
in covering up sexual misconduct as characterized in this report, you don't see any example of offense, whether it's misleading, whether it's a misleading people, whether it's perjury, whether it is in fact having people who work for you go out and make statements you know to be false. None of that reaches the level of an impeachable offense for you.
It's hard for me to see this as an impeachable offense. It's certainly wrong. Some of it may even have been criminal, but it is very hard to make out an abuse of power here.
If it's criminal, why isn't it a grounds for impeachment?
I think it's generally recognized that a lot of things that are grounds for impeachment are not criminal. A president who goes off and on his own launches a military attack on Canada would be committing an impeachable offense, but no crime. And conversely, a president who commits a crime, let's say adultery, nothing more, which in many states is still a crime, surely is not abusing his power and committing an impeachable offense.
Let me go to
This is closer to the line because there's at least a patina of obstruction of justice, but it turns out that it's all so thin and so circumstantial that there may be more smoke there than fire.
Bill Buckley, you have said on this program the president ought to resign. Did anything today that you saw change your mind as to what ought to be the course for the president?
No, nothing at all, Charlie. I think what we got today was simply a very ample confirmation of what we expected. And I think it's correct to focus on what many of the loyalists in the White House court bring up frequently, which is that this is now a political question. It's not a legal question. It could also be a legal question, but it's not primarily a legal question. The important thing to remember, it seems to me, is that he acknowledged doing what he did. And what he did was to violate, at the most rudimentary level, personal codes of honor and professional codes of honor. Everything else is ancillary. What he then did to attempt to cover his tracks, to deceive the American people, invoking the most solemn relationship that a president can invoke, i.e., I want you to believe me on this, is what we are left with as the political question, i.e., can we trust the judgment of that kind of man? Remember, this was not an impulsive overnight act. It was a systematic 37-meeting relationship. And as such, it seems to be extremely difficult to say with any confidence that we can trust this man to be to exercise the kind of authority that's vested in that office.
Does it inexorably follow then that if he doesn't, that you believe if he doesn't resign, he should be impeached?
At this point, I think he should, yeah. I think that it would accomplish two things. It would suggest that public sensibilities are sharp enough to reject something as abusive as this. Let me just remind you that Senator Lieberman said in his now famous statement that this conduct was, he used a couple of unfriendly words, and also unacceptable. Now, if it's unacceptable, how can we accept it? I remember years ago, Norman Thomas, he was running for president as a socialist, said to me, there are 10 million Americans who aren't earning a living wage. I said, why aren't they dead? Now, by the same token, if it's not acceptable,
how
do we do it?
Yeah. Can I break in just for a moment?
Yes, please do, Larry, and then I'll come back.
I think our system of government would be in very grave danger if we accepted Bill Buckley's approach. There are a lot of times that presidents of both parties have done things that a majority of the House of Representatives and maybe even two-thirds of the Senate would think are terrible and unacceptable and do not show wisdom or character. But if that meant that, as with a parliamentary system, we could simply on that ground, without any specific high crime and misdemeanor, undo the results of the last election.
They are acceptable. If you say your point is that they should be accepted,
no, that's just
unacceptable.
That's a verbal trick, Bill. But one can indicate the unacceptability of conduct by a resolution of censure, by all kinds of things. It does not require the enormous wrenching act of undoing the results of an election to express the sense that something simply is unacceptable and must not be tolerated.
Well, yeah, you can say the summer's heat is unacceptable, and it simply becomes a loose, idiomatic way of describing a situation. But the kind of solemnity with which that statement was made by Senator Lieberman attracts us to the uses of language.
Let me come back to the questions of language, but first I'm going to bring Gardner Taylor in. Reverend Gardner Taylor is a friend of mine. He's also a good friend of the president. I don't know when you have most recently seen him. When have you seen him?
Had prayer with him on the telephone a couple of weeks ago.
Had prayer with him on the telephone. How do you get your hands around this issue of what the president has done and his fitness for office?
That it is wrong, he has confessed. And I think anyone with normal moral sensitivity would agree that it was not the right, it was very wrong. But we are all flawed people. And the people, if people are going to judge him, those who judge him are flawed. And if you give me $20 million, I'll find something wrong with everybody connected here. Give me $40 million and I'll find something wrong with Apostle Paul and Mother Teresa. There's no question about that. But
what's the argument here, that everybody sins and so therefore we shouldn't hold the president accountable for his sins?
I think we should hold him accountable, yes. But I do not believe that this transgression rises to the level of impeachment. I think censure would say that the society does not approve of this. Those who will be doing the censuring are guilty of many things themselves.
But that's not the issue today. The issue is the president's conduct, and you think censure might be an appropriate...
It would seem to me.
And his judgment.
And sorry, what?
And his judgment is an issue. Because anybody who can get into this kind of a mess is insecure in his judgment.
And you believe, Bill, that every president who has shown that he has bad judgment should be impeached and removed from office? That can't be right.
Well, no, obviously not. But I'm saying that I do not know of a comparable, protracted misjudgment of that can come close to this.
Oh, I would think
this was one misjudgment.
Iran-Contra is a good counterexample.
Let me bring Margaret in because I don't want to get into the debate between Iran-Contra and what the president did. I want to come to Margaret Carlson. Just tell me what this day has been like for those of you. You're at Time Magazine and you're preparing a magazine and waiting for this and watching the president. I mean, give us a sense of...
We're staring at our screens, reading chunks of this report and looking in some measure for what's new. What is in that report that we didn't already know about and could start a new furor? We didn't find anything new that we didn't know about.
So nothing you didn't or hadn't already heard because of leaks one or another.
One way or the other.
Right.
There were some things, some details that we certainly hadn't heard, and I think that the devil is in these details. I'll say that in front of a man of the cloth, but the details are very alarming, and you know, I wouldn't want to know these things about illicit sexual affair, much less an illicit
one.
The
details are alarming. Why?
Well, they're very specific. I don't know these things about anybody.
But because of the details and because they're alarming, it leads you to what conclusions as to what ought to happen to the President of the United States?
I don't think it changes the conclusion. What it does is the public sensibility that Larry and Mr. Buckley were talking about, it could affect that. And the impeachment standard is quite vague. I think the Founding Fathers left it that way, and Larry was alluding to some of that, although he seems to know more about what it is than some others. And the Congress is going to base their judgment of that on how the public thinks. They're not going to go out and impeach,
because it's a political process,
a president that the public is firmly behind. I think it's going to take a few days to find out how's the public going to take it.
So all we're going to do is sit here and wait for public opinion?
The Congress should take into account public opinion, mm-hmm. because you don't undo an election without some sense of how the people feel about it.
Could I urge you all to read Margaret Carlson's terribly witty piece in Time, this issue, in which she says that some people tend to refer to this as the kind of thing that would be no big deal in France. Yeah. Well, in making a statement like that, I think she very adroitly says that things have to be measured by how they are contextually. And now she has just added what she wrote, what she is prompted to say after reading this, writing this brilliant column, that she couldn't even imagine the lengths to which the president went. Now, I happen not to care about that aspect of it. I think it's sociologically and perhaps psychologically interesting, but I do care that over an 18-month period, somebody should think to profane that office and to take advantage of this woman in a way that would be terribly offensive if it were done by one's son, let alone the arbiter of our governmental future.
So in the end, Bill, when you cut it every way, you say this president has defamed the office, and therefore, in the interest of the country, in the interest of...
Not quite.
No.
I say that the way he has done it gives ground to doubts about his judgment, and this is the judgment of a man I don't want to sit in that office, I, as one American citizen.
Because he took risk or because he lacks moral judgment?
Well, the risk had to do with the moral judgment. That is to say, the utter and total mess that he and the country are in have resulted from his systematic exploitation of a situation which nobody with a grain of sense would expose himself to. And for that reason, I think he's simply incapacitated.
But, you know, remember that for months now, people have been saying what a terrible misjudgment and worse was involved in sex with the intern, and it's right. The details of that that Margaret Carlson is talking about, and I agree with that, but people have been saying that alone would of course not justify impeachment and removal. It's all about what you will see when the report comes out. It's all about an orchestrated scheme to obstruct justice. That's the other shoe that didn't really drop today, because
the independent counsel thinks there is conclusive and supportive evidence that
he perjured himself.
That says it did drop.
No, well, he didn't say conclusive, and if he did, who would care? The point is, he is presenting, as he should, one side of the picture. Remember, the grand jury doesn't hear the other side. It doesn't have cross-examination of the witnesses. And what we have is the attempt by the independent counsel, charged by law to make that attempt, to suggest that there is credible evidence of what he thinks may be impeachable offenses. That's fine. But now the constitutional obligation falls upon Congress not to defer to the independent counsel, but to decide for itself whether Mr. Buckley is right and reckless misjudgment is enough to remove someone from office, whether those who find just the sex itself so distasteful and disgusting and reprehensible should prevail, or whether we should establish a different standard.
We don't care whether he thinks it's impeachable, do we? I mean, that's just his opinion, by which I mean 100 people can take 100 different shades of opinion on what is impeachable.
Bill, I got to get Gardner Taylor in.
Sorry.
When you listen to the argument of Bill Buckley, defame the office, the Oval Office, an intern, 18-month period, judgment, all of that. Do you...
Reprehensible, but the office has been defamed since Thomas Jefferson, if we're going to take that standard. And this does not pardon, rule out what the president has done, but to start looking for perfection is to start looking for an impossibility. And if the president has admitted his fault, which no other president in history has ever done, to my knowledge, and has said that he wants to move on. But if you're talking about bad judgment in matters, private matters, then you can go all the way back. We'll have very few presidents left in our history.
If I pay you $40 million, can you find perfection?
I didn't understand you.
You say you can find anything for $40 million.
I can find
imperfection. Can you find perfection for $40 million?
Perfection.
No, I don't think you can find perfection with $100 million or $1 billion for that matter. It's not in the earth. So.
Did you had a private phone conversation from your friend, the president, who calls you in pain and anguish, I assume, to talk, right? Correct.
We had prayer.
Do you see a difference this morning at the prayer breakfast? I know you didn't see the breakfast itself, but you've seen some of the rebroadcast from the man this morning than from the man 2 weeks ago.
Yes, I think the process has gone on to another level. And I think today there was an extreme brokenness, and contrition, and a plea for forgiveness.
That wasn't there in terms of...
Not quite to that extent, no.
It would be great. I think it'd be a great tragedy, though, if we made this turn on how good an actor the president is. I mean, though I want to say that I am surprised not to find much more in this report, I also want to say that it understates the seriousness of the president's initial misconduct to say that he wasn't quite perfect. He was far short of perfect. Yeah. But the real question is whether he committed the kind of abuse of office that makes it impossible, really, to trust the man.
And there's
a vicious circle, because I suppose if all the pundits and all the press say nobody trusts him, you'll see the poll numbers gradually move.
I've got to come to Margaret because she's busy trying to getting back to do a magazine. So where are we? And I mean, is it simply a question now of seeing what the defense for the president is as they try to lay out the defense, to watch what happens with members of Congress in terms of, it clearly is going to be an inquiry. I mean, that's clearly going to take place.
That seems clear. The White House has already put out a 73-page defense, which makes the best case for the president, but which has to tread this line that I think is very unfortunate, which is to parse again exactly what he did and why what he said about it is not perjury. And the Congress is going to look at that. It raises exactly what happened between Monica Lewinsky and himself, and it's an I didn't inhale defense to try to get out of having committed perjury in the Paula Jones deposition and perhaps before the grand jury. That's what makes these details possible to discuss in this legal document. That's what it's going to come down to, because the Congress has already said that sex alone, however awful it was, defiling the office, as Mr. Buckley says, defiling the marriage, would not be enough to impeach him, but perjury would. And so it's all going to come down to whether the perjury that Starr documents in this report is impeachable, and whether impeachment is the punishment that fits that crime.
Those things are different from what this current defense by the White House lawyers does. I think it's pretty bad lawyering, frankly, because what they're now trying to do is not simply make those broad points that even if everything that is alleged was true, it's not impeachable and so on, but they are, again, trying to sound like lawyers and parsing this so fine that it really sounds like a repeat of the claim by the president that what he said may have not been quite right.
Go ahead.
Legally accurate.
I got a question.
The lawyers are the worst thing here, in that when you hear that, it takes away from the sense of shame and contrition that the president has finally expressed.
Exactly. Bill, having been an observer of the presidency for a number of years now, if this president on January, way back in January, had made the kind of statement he made today, do you think it would have made all the difference in the world as to where we are?
I think it would have made a considerable difference because he would at least have been relieved of the lack of confidence that derives from the 6 months.
And he wouldn't have misled anybody, and he would not have had testified before a grand jury, and he wouldn't have done those kinds of things.
But
none of that, to take your previous argument as to why he should resign, was really because of what he had done and because of his misjudgment. Now, why then, if he had apologized in January...
Except my argument is a cumulative misjudgment. It's a misjudgment in having done it over a period of 18 months, and then followed it by an attempt to deceive the American people for 6 months.
I'm about to lose you, Bill. Thank you very much for joining us. I think the satellite is going to say goodbye, and I don't want to cut you off in mid-sentence.
Thank you.
Bill Buckley from Stanford. Larry Tribe, what do you think is going to happen? Tell me what your gut tells you about this story.
I don't have a good crystal ball on this one. I honestly don't. I do think that given all of the buildup about the report, I suspect that quite a few people will react as I have, saying, as people, I guess Gertrude Stein once said about Oakland, there isn't any there. Well, there is some there here. There is misconduct. But because it's so much less than many have been led to expect, except for the sexual details, which I don't think are a basis for impeachment, I think that the momentum may be slowed by this report. And that's critical, because that will enable the House of Representatives, which I'm sure will go ahead with a kind of inquiry, not get steamrolled.
I saw some of that today. I thought there was a deflation when the report came. It just felt like that from the commentary on TV around the office, that because the report was slightly underwhelming in that we'd been led to believe it was really going to make the case and it was going to have some new information, and it didn't, there was a slight slowing down. And a big part of this is the momentum and the melodrama. And you have to have a car chase every so often to keep it going. And this wasn't exactly the car chase. I still think how the public reacts to knowing
we'll come back to Gardner, but I assume what that is how they react to, in a sense, the details of it's part of what my gut tells me, how the public reacts to the details of what went on as to whether there will be some kind of revulsion will then play into the political end of it.
The pure politics. This is not the impeachable part as much as the pure politics, which then gives the Congress the steam to to go on and impeach him if the public is revolted.
I know politics is not your field, but
is it possible, do you think, that there could just be, when they read the details of this, that the public can say, I just don't want my president doing that, and therefore, please leave, you know, in the great words of...
I think the people of this country have more moral sensitivity than that. I think they feel that there ought to be some rebuke. I do not feel that they think that there ought to be impeachment. And if I may say so, I don't think it would have made a bit of difference if he'd confessed earlier. I think there was determination to bring this president down by one reason or another, by one means or another. When one failed, another attempt was made until they finally found something which they think, prosecutor, persecutor, however you want to characterize him, special counsel, whatever. Will hold.
You come to the conclusion that in the end that this was an organized effort or some kind of effort by the right in America or the Republicans or to take this president out?
Charlie, I have absolutely no doubt in my mind that this has been a studied, planned thing, greatly financed by hidden figures with a lot of money.
Notwithstanding that, and there is some evidence
cooperated
of that,
in
the president,
yeah, I agree.
In a sense, it's ultimately responsible.
No question about that.
In the words of Richard Nixon, I gave them a sword.
No question. But to go into all of these graphic details and to spread them before the American people, it seems to me that this is a deliberate attempt to smear and to destroy.
But Charlie, you make a point. The president handed his enemies a gift.
He did indeed.
And where the recklessness comes in is, here's a man who already has a civil suit against him, has a prosecutor with $40 million in his own career at stake, watching his every move, and he's conducting this affair. That's reckless. I disagree with Bill Buckley in that I don't see the president as a reckless man in any other area.
Certainly not in his political life.
I don't see that there. I don't see that carry over in his life. But this one area may overwhelm some of the others. There may just be a spillover so that people can no longer look at the president in the same way.
You know, his gifts are part of his problem. Any talent comes like a coin showing the side to the sun. The underside is shadowed. Talent comes with price, and I think you have that flaw in his personality, but I think that flaw is a perverted form of his gifts.
What is the flaw, as you characterize it?
Sexual appetite.
Sexual appetite. Mm.
Yes. I think it comes out in a weird way from his gifts of loving people, his compassion, his ability to embrace people, and which I think is indicated by the two elections.
You think we make too much of excessive sexual appetite?
I don't think it's the only thing. I think there's a puritanical background in America. I heard a preacher preach Sunday, Johnny Youngblood, and he said about Jesus and the woman taken in adultery. He said that Jesus wrote in the sand because he wanted to erase it all. Marvelous point. I'd never heard that kind of thing. He wanted to erase it all, and he erased all they had done and what she had done, told her to go in peace. So there we are.
Thank you very much, Gardner Taylor. Pleasure to see you again.
Glad to see you.
Thank you, Margaret. My thanks also to Lawrence Tribe from Harvard Law School, Bill Buckley at Stamford, Connecticut. We'll be right back. Stay with us. For all questions of legality, in the end, the question of what happens to the president may turn on his own explanation, his own asking for forgiveness, and how the American people react to what they find out about his conduct in the White House. For a consideration of the moral dimensions, joining me now, the Reverend James A. Forbes. He is senior minister of the Riverside Church in New York, and also the Reverend J. Philip Wogaman. He is minister of the Founder United Methodist Church in Washington. Both of them were present when the president asked for forgiveness this morning and called himself a sinner. Reverend Wogaman, take me to the room this morning. Your own feelings as you listen to the president. You have watched him, advised him, counseled with him, have been his pastor during this crisis of the spirit. Tell me about him and about what you heard this morning.
Well, first, I make no pretenses about my own role, of course. The place was the East Room at the White House. It was crowded with clergy and other representatives of religious communities from across the country, ranging through the Protestant, Catholic, Jewish, Muslim, Hindu, many different faiths. And in that place, I think we all gathered with a deep sense of foreboding about this time in our history, and maybe a lot of hopes and fears and all. And the president himself set the tone. He gave what I considered his deepest statement about this tragedy that has affected him and the nation. He's obviously pondered it very deeply. He'd been up most of the night working on it. I felt it came from the heart. It's the strongest and deepest and best statement I have heard from him on this. And I think it was very healing and helpful. He recognizes there was no lack of contrition and repentance. That was all very deep and sincere, and he wasn't blaming anybody but himself. He acknowledged that it may even be a good thing for him.
What did he mean by that?
Well, to have had to face up to this, and to face up to the need to change. Repentance has to be preceded by a deeply felt need to change, and I think I saw that. It's been gathering in him for a long time, and not just since the crisis broke. But
what has been gathered with him?
The sense of a need to change.
In conversations with you, you picked that up?
I'll not detail any of that, but I yes.
Sense that he needed to change his habits, he needed to consider what kind of person he wanted to be.
Yeah, and it doesn't mean that what has happened here in this this scandal defines who he is as a person. It's the most flawed part of his being, of his personality, but there's so many good things about this man. He's a great and effective leader, and a lot of just plain old human goodness and caring in him. I think the American people have now had several years to experience this, and we at the church that he has been identified with here have experienced much of this firsthand. But here are the flaws, and one has to somehow gather grace and strength from the strong points of one's life to deal with the weak points.
You were there.
I was there.
What would you add to this sense of this meeting, this president, this that you also know?
I would add that, along with many clergy who have been used to receiving pleas for repentance and requests for forgiveness, we're pretty good at detecting when it's genuine. We can discern authenticity pretty well. This was an authentic moment, if my experience is of any value.
So if those who cynics come forward to say it looked genuine, it felt genuine, but the president had no other course, and so he's just trying this.
Yes, you know, I remember
he had to be led here, he had to be brought here, and he finally was convinced that it was something he had to do in order to save his skin.
I would say that I have been a part of the group that said, I wish he had said the full truth January. I wish that he had been more contrite when he made his response in August. But today, I finally understood that, you know, programmatically you can plan an apology, but until it comes from a deep place inside of you, it's not real. And so if it has taken the pressure, the anticipation of very serious disclosures in the Star Report, fine. I thought that whatever the Spirit had been attempting to use, the Spirit was very effective in bringing him to genuine conviction. That means he's not just playing it or not just manipulating us about it. I think I experienced a man who believes this is a watershed moment, and that his character and approach to life will be impacted by the values that have reasserted themselves in the light of this conflict.
Let's accept both of that. I mean, the good faith, as we should, accept what the president said this morning. There are those who say, I'm prepared to do that, but I think for the good of the country, because of all, and because this will continue to be in the public debate, the president should step down. That's the honorable thing. that's the thing that would best serve the office that he has held. Reverend Wogaman?
Well, I speak to that. I think that would be a tragic mistake. Best for the country? I don't think so. I think it would set an example to the country that the way we deal with sin and repentance is we trash people. I think far better for the country itself to rally around in love and caring and forgiveness and saving the immense gifts that this man represents. He was a elected president to fill out a term. I think it'd be far better for him and for the country for us to go ahead on this. It does need to be marked out as a form of behavior that's unacceptable. We understand that. But to discard him now, what a message that would send to millions of people who struggle with these same issues and who need the same kind of forgiveness that he needs and need to be able to reconstitute their lives and move ahead.
Will you read the Star report, Reverend Wogaman?
I beg your pardon?
Are you planning to read the Star report?
Oh, I suppose I will. I don't need to know all the gory details. I was a little appalled at the exhibition of some of the networks today and just rushing out there with all that they could find. I'm not sure that elevates our moral tone of our society. But I think I will need to look at it and to take it seriously. I think I already know the broad outlines and what really needs to be known.
There are a lot of particulars in there.
What?
There are a lot of particulars in there.
Well, of course. I would assume that there are.
You advise the president, I'm going to lose you by satellite, so I'm staying with you just a second.
Yes.
From Washington. So your advice to the president tonight is what? As a friend, as a counselor, as a pastor?
My advice is to be steadfast. To be steadfast in his repentance and to follow through with the moves that are needed to really make the changes effective in his life. To be steadfast in his commitment to the country and to be steadfast in the face of the storm.
And for those Americans who may find it hard to believe the president after they read what's in the Star report, after they read the allegations made by the independent counsel in terms of lying, in terms of misleading, in terms of personal conduct, and they say to you, why should we believe him now?
Yeah. Well, it wouldn't hurt to at least wait to hear what he has to say. I was a little surprised that the special counsel felt that he couldn't give the White House a courtesy of an advance look so that their response could be, in effect, in the same news cycle as the Star report. But be that as it may, we know him to be a good person, to have been an extraordinary, effective leader, and to know that
it is part of the Judeo-Christian tradition.
Yes, and I don't know any flawless leader. I don't know any flawless people. We're all sinners struggling together, and to set an example of forgiveness and love, I think that lays the foundation for real morality far more than further legalism about this and further invasions of his personal life.
I thank you for joining us.
Yeah,
it's a pleasure to have you on this program, and I hope we can talk further.
Good.
I'm going to lose you by satellite.
Okay.
I don't want to do it in mid-sentence.
Right.
I come back to Jim Forbes at the Riverside Church. Have you personally counseled the president?
Have
you been in private conversation with him or with the First Lady?
Over the years, I have made challenges to the First Lady on behalf of the president. Have not spoken directly to him in this particular crisis, but my prayers have been for him, and today I am happy. I think he has had a personal moment of encounter that is going to impact his character, whether or not he's in the presidency or not.
So maybe something good came out of this.
Some good has come out of it, I hope.
Reverend Forbes, thank you as always.
My pleasure.
Back in a moment. Stay with us. While the rest of the country was preoccupied with the crisis we have been talking about, at the U.S. Open, the focus was on tennis. Joining me tonight to talk about the tournament so far and with a preview for this weekend's finals, Bud Collins, columnist for the Boston Globe and a reporter for NBC. Cliff Drysdale, a former professional player and now tennis analyst for ESPN.
Tom Gullikson, the U.S. Davis Cup captain and director of coaching for the USTA Player Development Program, and Pam Shriver, also a former professional player, now an ESPN tennis analyst who will be working for CBS this weekend. I am pleased to have all of them. Let me start with my colleague here, Mr. Collins. Tell me about so far. What surprises have you taken note of, and how do you feel about
the tournament so far? I like the tournament so far. There haven't been any really great matches yet, although if you stayed up late last night with Mark Philippoussis saving three match points in a fifth-set tiebreaker to beat that Swede, Tom Johansson, that was a thrilling match. Rafter escaping in the first round from the most beautiful player to watch in the world, I think, Isha Marazi, the young Moroccan.
The most beautiful player to watch in the world?
Yes.
Because?
He just so glides through everything. He has marvelous touch. He's left-handed. He's very Laverian. But like Marcelo Rios, he's got head problems. So that was a wonderful match. And Carlos Moya escaping from match points from Michael Chang, who seemed to be getting himself a right. He won in Boston, but... it was Moya. Moya's going to surprise a lot of people. He may not win, don't you think, but he can volley.
All right, let me go around. Tom, so far, what do you think of this tournament? What do you like about it?
You know, I think there's great matchups, you know, in the semifinals. And the men, certainly, you know, Sampras views of the U.S. Open as his tournament. He's won it four times, and he gets the opportunity to play.
Also feels that way about Wimbledon.
Yeah, Patrick Rafter, you know, who took his tournament last year, defending champion, and after that hiccup against Arazi in the first round, I don't think I've ever seen Rafter play better. He's serving and volleying, chipping and charging. He's such a great athlete. I think that's going to be a terrific match tomorrow between Sampras and Rafter.
All right, let me just then focus on the future then. Sampras favorite in that?
I think so. I think he's 8
because it's home court.
He's 8-2 lifetime, and when he has kind of revenge as a motive, that pumps him up, and certainly he's really focused in the majors. So I think Sampras will win that match.
What about the other semifinal, men's semifinal?
Moya?
Yeah.
I like Philippoussis. Two great-looking guys, by the way. The Australian is just fantastic. Moya, I mean, from Spain's got about everything you could possibly want to watch. Two very beautiful matches to watch.
Yeah. Let me go to the women's, and we'll talk about men's with you as well. But I saw a little bit of Venus Williams today and Lindsay Davenport. What did you think of that match?
Well, I thought it was a great match of two big heavy hitters in women's tennis, both over 6'1" tall, and both hit the ball well. Lindsay Davenport won through 4-4, so it's her first ever Grand Slam final. It was just a year ago here at the U.S. Open she had her first breakthrough to a semifinal. And, of course, everybody from the United States standpoint hopes that Lindsay Davenport can walk away tomorrow with her first ever Grand Slam title. She's 2 in the world, and she's been chasing Hingis all summer, playing really the best tennis of anyone on the tour, only had one loss since Wimbledon. So Davenport's looking good.
I think she can do it.
I think she can. I mean, Hingis is stubborn. She's shown in the past, and she's not playing her best tennis, but she's beaten Seles and then Novotna back-to-back matches, and she's scraping by. And number one players become champions, I think, when they can still win when they're not quite playing their best, and she's proven she can do that the last couple of matches.
Let me stay with the women. What do you think about?
I like Hingis in that match. She's so resourceful. She finds a way down 1-4 to the Wimbledon champion, Novotna, and she finds a way to win. She was chipping and charging herself in the second set to win at 6-1. Kind of stunned Jana when she did that. And I just think she's so thoughtful and can do it. People say she's not big enough. Now, I think Lindsay ought to give her one of the bumps on the change games like we saw from Spirula and Venus, because that would be the end of Hingis, of course. But I think Hingis is going to take a lot of beating.
Tom, women's finals?
The women's final. I like Davenport. I think she's confident. She's won 3 tournaments this summer on the hard courts in her nice California swing out there on the West Coast. And she's matured a lot. I like her body language a lot better. In the past, when she has been playing... you could just see the disappointment. You could see her sagging on the court, and I think she's carrying herself with much more confidence. So I like Lindsay Davenport.
Yeah. Women's tennis is carrying itself very well. Let's start out by saying there's Kournikova, the youngsters and the oldsters, and those in
Venus
between.
And her sister.
Yeah, it's just great. It's lovely to see. I think the men are doing fine as well, by the way, by comparison with the women. There's no doubt the women's tennis has never been better. I know Pam is just thrilled with that. I'm going to go with Hingis. One of the reasons that women's tennis is doing so well is because of Hingis. I mean, but for one match, she would have won the Grand Slam last year. She's won one slam this year. I hope she stays number one in the world in a certain way. Lindsay Davenport is playing as well as she's ever played. If she ever has a chance to be number one, it's tomorrow.
Will Seles ever be number one again?
Well, I don't know if she can be number one again, but I do think she can win Grand Slam singles titles again. And, you know, it's just a matter of time. We'll see. In the next 6 to 9 months, she really wants to get in tip-top shape. She has one of the best fitness coaches working with her right now, Gavin Hopper. And I think the desire is there. But to be number one, I that may have passed her. But I think right now she'd like to just win some majors again.
Yeah, I saw the Hingis match and saw some of the old form. Yeah. A lot of the grunting was
Well,
there.
I think Pam is right. She's got Gavin Hopper, who's out there, a real slave driver, but he brought Amanda Kutzer up. He's with Philippoussis. He knows how to train her. I think Celis takes kind of a knock in that they say, well, she isn't slim. She's never going to be slim. She's never going to be svelte. Body conditions are different, but I think she will get extremely fit, and I do think she can win a major again.
Who's the best coach in the game, Tom?
You!
Well, I think my brother was probably one of the best coaches ever.
Sampras would certainly believe
I'm
that.
I'm a little bit biased, obviously. I think there are some great coaches, and there's different types of coaches. I mean, there's the mentor types, the older guys like Tony Picard, who was more like a father figure to a guy like Stefan Edberg, and he really not only coached him, but he mentored him. And there's some coaches that are a little bit younger who are very good. I think Jose Aguirre, who coach Michael Chang to his first Grand Slam, first and only Grand Slam at 17, and obviously Coach Currier, number one in the world. Jose Aguirre is a terrific coach. So I think there's many, many good coaches.
Who's the best analyst?
Well, obviously, I'm looking at three terrific analysts. We can just go right around the table, and if you were analyzing, I'd say you were good, too.
Who's the best politician?
Let me just go to the men's finals. Do you expect to be Sampras to win?
I have a Raptor feeling. And
you do. Raptor beats Sampras, and then he wins.
And maybe he wins. I think he will. Here's the great scenario for people down under would be Philippoussis against Raptor. Hasn't been the Australians used to own this tournament, since Slaver beat Roach in 1969, there hasn't been such a... There used to be year after year. But this down there, Philippoussis is the bad Australian. Raptor is the good Australian. It's a great morality play. Because Philippoussis refused to play Davis Cup. And, of course, Raptor got his big lift toward what he is now by playing Davis Cup.
Men's finals.
Marcel Darius is not a good guy, by the way, and that's the difference between Philippoussis. Let's be honest with you. The
guy's sort of kid.
Yeah, good kid. That's what I'm trying to make the point.
Little
he didn't play Davis Cup, and he barely. Men's final, Pete Sampras.
Going to
beat Sampras. Rafter, he's got the goods on
Rafter. He's the best player in the tournament.
As Billy says,
Sampras is the best player in the tournament.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And he's the best player in the world?
Yes, no doubt about it. I don't think anybody comes close at this point.
I end with this. There's so much we have to do this evening, so I'm making it a little bit shorter than normal. I had a conversation the other night with Fred Stolle, and he told me that the best...
conversation, you just listened.
I listened.
All right.
He says the best player, that Sampras can never be the greatest player ever to play the game, no matter how many Grand Slams he wins, unless he wins the French. You agree with that?
Oh, yes.
That's true.
Oh, I don't know if it's true, but I agree with
you. You agree with that?
No.
No, you don't. You can be the greatest player ever to play the game and not win the French.
Yes, of course you can. If he wins enough Grand Slams and his record is better than anybody else's, of course he can.
Okay. The greatest player ever to play the game on the men's side so far is Lou Hode or Rod Laidlaw?
Well, no, this is a long discussion. You've got to go to, you've got to go to Gonzalez.
Throw
you've got
off
to
the next two guests.
Some very good ones in the
Tom, you have an
eye. Well, I think the danger for Pete Sampras is if he and Raptor have a great match, and he wins a tough match, he may have a letdown in the finals because he may have felt that that was really a final.
Very
so, I think, certainly either Moya or Philippoussis might sneak in with a chance if the winner of the Raptor-Sampras match has a little bit of a letdown.
And also the schedule, depending on how late tomorrow's night's second men's semi. Yeah. A lot of times it's funny what the schedule can do. Back-to-back matches, U.S. Open's the only Grand Slam that doesn't give a day's rest for the men between semis and finals.
Is that because of television or something
else? Exactly.
Television runs.
See how smart I am.
And in fact, Sampras.
Well, it's your meat and potatoes.
Sampras lost to Edberg in that final after he played a long second match and he had the IV, and then it hurt him in the final the next day against Edberg.
Tennis needs television badly. Let it run tennis
because we
need it.
Yeah. Absolutely. Don't forget the Gullikson Foundation.
Tell me about the Gullikson Foundation before I go. I know
we're doing some good things. You mentioned you were going down to Duke fairly, in the near future. We just gave them a $500,000 grant over the next 5 years.
For research?
To establish a family support system for people with brain tumors and their families. So we're doing some good things.
Good for you. Thank you all.
Thank
pleasure.
You.
Thank you.
U.S. Open.
Saturday and Sunday. I look forward to it. President. You get me a seat when you
have the president will have you in his box, I'm sure. It's television.
You can be the umpire.
Thank you for joining us this evening. We'll see you tomorrow night. No, we're not. We'll see you on Monday night. See you then.
Charlie Rose is made possible by USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com. Where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.